Assalamualaikum and a very good evening to our beloved lecturer Dr. Aida Maria binti Ismail and our fellow friends. Today, our group wants to present about the case 26, which is Restoring Trust in Corporate Governance, Hongwei Holding Berhad. This is our group member, which are Muhammad Adam Faiz, Muhammad Nabil, Zaima Amalini, Nek Morni, Nek Nur Syamimi and me, myself, Fatina Zakia. Now, I will present on what we have discovered in this case. First, I would like to tell you about the background of the company. Hongwei is a Malaysian-based company that specializes in manufacturing shoes. It was established in 1993. It started as a family-run business till it currently well-known as a high-quality footwear brand. Hongwei has 5 subsidiaries all over the world. This business has their own target market, which are middle-aged working adults where the soles can meet the demand of this demographic. Hongwei has produced 4 types of shoes, which are thermoplastic rubber TPR shoe soles, rubber RB shoe soles, MD1 shoe soles, MD2 shoe soles. Hongwei keep doing great in the market despite of the slow growth of the global footwear industry. Okay, let's move to the industry analysis. First is target market. The target market of Hongwei is young and middle-aged working adults. For the competitor, it is a high competition as the demand of their footwear is increased. For the risk and challenge is due to the rising price of raw material. So the company needs to increase selling price in order to cover up their increasing cost of pair of the shoes. For the current trend of Hongwei is it is driven by the growth in fashion industry, increasing demand for new design of footwear and awareness about a healthy and active lifestyle. Okay, now let's move to the SWOT analysis. First of all, we talk about the strength of Hongwei. It is a well-known brand of high-quality footwear, which is it's also a public listed company as over the last 20 years, Hongwei has strived to become one of the key players in Malaysia's footwear. It also has 5 wholly owned subsidiaries. For the weaknesses of Hongwei is they having problem in the internal control, which led to the inability to obtain sufficient assurance. It also facing problem with inventory. It is due to the unable to obtain appropriate evidence from its subsidiary. For the opportunity, the emerging role of e-commerce has led to the increasing new brands. This would enhance the demand of footwear in coming years. For the threat, this is due to the slow growth of the footwear industry. Hongwei may face rising costs of local labor, rising price of raw material. It also faced the global competition that contribute to slow growth of footwear industry.
Then, as for the company's position, by referring to the position of Hongwei Berhad, the company engaged in footwear production and specializing in shoe soles. The company was led by its founder, who has more than 20 years of experience in the shoe sole production industry. Hongwei has become a well-known brand of a high-quality footwear as the year passed by. Now, they managed to have 5 subsidiaries. The company are eager to become one of the key players in Malaysian footwear industry and they are committed to produce a comfortable and a high quality shoes at affordable price as its customer satisfaction is their top priority. For the best practice, Hongwei has the capabilities to produce 4 types of shoes, which are TPR, RB, MD1 and MD2. The company are working on maintaining a good relationship with other footwear associations in the world. They are also organizing footwear competition in Malaysia to encourage young talents to join in the footwear industry and organizing trade missions to overseas exhibitions. They also have participated actively in shoe fairs worldwide. Then, let's we have a look at Hongwei's financial condition. For current ratio, we know that the company will not have any difficulty to pay its current obligation on time. Meanwhile, as for 2016, from the calculation, we know that the company may face some problems, plus there were not enough information that was disclosed by the company, so the interpretation cannot provide further. The second ratio is net profit margin. The net profit margin for the group in both year 2015 and 2016 shows a negative amount. From this ratio, we know that the company is no longer profitable nor financially stable, especially for 2016. Therefore, Hongwei will be struggling terribly to improve their performance. understand, I will pass to the next presenter for the further explanation on the case.
Next, let's move to mapping case to key syllabus. First, corporate governance. Corporate governance refers to the systems of rules, policies, and the process that govern corporations. In this way, a company's corporate governance model is defined as the allocation of rights and obligations among all members of the organization. Governance guarantees that everyone in the company follows proper and transparent decision-making procedures and that all stakeholders' interests are protected, including shareholders, managers, employees, suppliers, and customers. Next, what is good corporate governance? Good CG is referring to the processes of disclosure and transparency are followed in order to provide regulators and shareholders as well as the general public with exact and accurate information about the financial, operational and other aspects that related with the company. It means that the good corporate governance is not only aimed for pursuing profits but doing so in a transparent and accountable manner. Here are several elements of good CG. First, clear organizational strategy. The foundation of good corporate governance is a well-defined organizational plan. For example, businesses must do a market research to find a profitable market, develop a product line to match the demands of that market, and then promote the product through a marketing strategy that directly addresses those customers. Hence, by knowing the overall strategy at each step, it can help the company staff keep focus on the organizational objective, which is to satisfy the demands of the customers in that target market. Besides that, corporate social responsibility is becoming more and more of a concern. Customers want businesses to contribute to their communities in positive ways, such as launching recycling activities and decreasing waste and pollution. Good corporate governance recognizes opportunities to enhance business processes and promote social good by reinvesting in the community. Lastly, transparency and information sharing. Managers sometimes may keep their own counsel, restricting the information that reaches staff. Corporate transparency, on the other hand, assists the unification of a company. Employees understand their position within the firm when they are permitted to evaluate the company's financial performance and comprehend management strategies. Transparency is also vital to the general public who are suspicious of secretive businesses.
Did you know that bad corporate governance can affect the business performance? So, I will elaborate further on what is the criteria of bad corporate governance. Okay, first, weak management is one strong sign of bad corporate governance. Weak corporate governance is a lack of effective governance and can happen when the board fails in its responsibility to ensure that its institution has proper procedures to monitor and control risk and to provide the necessary check on the executive. Second, the board of directors' lack of knowledge to make informed decisions. Even where the accounting systems produce accurate reporting, the board does not have the financial literacy to understand the nature of what is being reported. Okay, third, the board is primarily controlled by one individual who may frequently disregard expert advice or who may inappropriately delegate his or her responsibilities without providing proper supervision. Additionally, board accountability may become distorted because there may be insufficient examination of company decisions and reviews of company decisions may be completely absent. Next, we move on to impact of good corporate governance. First, it helps build moral reputation and legacy. By implementing practices that support good governance, helps to strengthen a firm's identity, allowing stakeholders and potential investors to place loyalty to the organization, allowing the company to develop stronger and long-term partnerships. Second, increase financial performance success rate and improve sustainability. The implementation of a good corporate governance is intended to aid in the ability to quickly identify issues as well as make quick decisions to resolve these potential issues, reducing the likelihood of a crisis and the cost associated with it. Third, increase the chances of gaining a competitive advantage. Every industry has the potential to evolve at some point, ensuring that the organization is adaptable to change and creating an environment where its practices can be sustained to ensure that the organization has a competitive advantage and a chance at survival. Now, let's take a look at what is the impact of bad corporate governance. A corporation that does not follow its corporate governance policy runs the danger of losing its shareholders' trust. This could happen if shareholders believe the company's organizational structure and business strategy are misleading. If shareholders fear the company is about to make a terrible business choice, they may start selling company stock to prevent a loss. When the value of a corporation stock drops, it becomes more difficult for the company to raise funds. This is partly attributable to a bad view of the corporation, resulting from a lack of compliance with its corporate governance strategies. A firm that has a reputation for not adhering to corporate governance strategies may face increased government inspection from departments attempting to ensure that the company is operating legally. Oversight may involve examinations of corporate operations such as employee compensation and relations, manufacturing facility quality, environmental impact of business practices, legality of all investments, and accurate reporting of all profits, debt, and losses. The ethical concern is over-inflating profits or minimizing losses can seriously damage the company's relationship with stockholders in that they are attracted to invest under false claim. A lack of transparency can also expose the Hongwei to fines from regulatory agencies. Okay, recommendation: to be transparent, Hongwei must accurately report their profits and losses and make those figures available to those who invest in their company.
I will continue with the next part, which is internal control. Based on my reading, internal control can be defined as a process affected by an entity's board of directors, management and other personnel designed to provide reasonable assurance regarding the achievement of objectives in the following categories. First, effectiveness and efficiency of operations. Second, reliability of financial reporting. And third, compliance with applicable laws and regulation. There are three purposes or benefits of internal control that I will discuss in this presentation. First is preventing and detecting fraud and other unlawful acts. Even small businesses with simple organization structures may fall victim to these violations, but as organizations increase in size and complexity, the nature of fraudulent practices becomes more diverse. Secondly, completeness and accuracy of financial records. An organization cannot produce financial statements if its financial records are unreliable. Systems should be capable of recording transactions so that the nature of business transacted is properly reflected in the financial accounts. And lastly, timely preparation of financial statements. Organizations should be able to fulfill their legal obligations to submit their account accurately and on time. Next, I will continue with ethical concern regarding internal control. Unfortunately, even though a company implements all of these features in its internal control structure, theft or fraud may still occur. If employees are dishonest, they can usually figure out a way to steal from a company. So as a recommendation, companies should carry adequate casualty insurance on assets. This insurance reimburses the company for loss of a non-monetary asset such as specialized equipment. Companies should also have fidelity bonds on employees handling cash and other negotiable instruments. These bonds ensure that a company is reimbursed for losses due to theft of cash and other monetary assets.
Next, I will proceed with auditing. Auditing is defined as the on-site verification activity such as the inspection or examination of a process or quality system to ensure the compliance to requirements. There are two types of audit, internal and external. An internal auditor is an auditor who is appointed by the board of directors of the company in order to carry out their internal audit function, while an external auditor is an independent entity which is from outside organization or from third parties who provide an unbiased opinion that follows a set of standards different from that of the company or organization. Now, move on to responsibilities of internal auditors, which consists of evaluating risk management activities within the organization, determining the organization's compliance with relevant laws and regulation, evaluating and making recommendations that can assist in improving internal control, investigating fraud via a fraud risk assessment that uses fraud deterrence principles, offering an objective source of independent advice to help reach the goal and achieve legality and validity, and lastly, gathering, analyzing, evaluating, and presenting the accounting documentation, reports, data, and flowcharts. After that, we have responsibilities of external auditors, which include audit financial statements and assess accounts for accuracy and regulatory compliance, investigating internal system controls and operation, assess risk management approach, perform audit for other departments such as non-financial areas, reporting systematic error or fraud indicators, and lastly, providing feedbacks by explaining audit findings and recommend solution. Next is the submission of annual report. The annual report is a document through which companies communicate details of their activities, financial results, and strategies to shareholders and other stakeholders. Company Act 2016 decouples the filing requirement of annual return and audited financial statement. Annual return is due on anniversary of a company's incorporation date and is required to lodge with the registrar within 30 days of due date. Next is the effect of audit report being delayed. The publishing of Hongwei's December 2015 annual report has been postponed due to an additional work required by the auditor, and permission to extend due date has been approved, but Hongwei still failed to comply. This has resulted in declining share price over the years as the investor has lost its interest towards the company. For ethical concerns, sometimes management may withhold or delay release critical information which should generally be provided on the basis of confidentiality or sensitivity. Management of Hongwei subsidiary did not give commitment towards the auditor, and as a recommendation, heads of internal audit function or service providers should bring to the attention of the chief executive officer and the audit committee any potential ethical issues relating to internal auditors or management. After that, for the roles and responsibility of the directors, Hongwei Holding Berhad was initially structured with one main chairman, which is the founder, Gary Menon, who manage his business with the help of one CEO, three independent non-executive directors, and one independent executive director. The chairman plays the role as the setter of the regulations of the organization, as well as supervising the overall aspect in the business. In order for the company to run smoothly, the delegations of duties to particular directors were made, as the directors were supposed to have an overview of the overall performance of the company.
Next, we will continue with case evaluation and reporting. For question 1, after analyzing the case, there are three main issues. For the first issue, which is no transparency, based on my research, transparency is one of corporate governance principles. Transparency means the company is responsible for the accurate, timely, and high-quality disclosure of all the firm's substantial announcements, including financial statements, annual reports, investor presentations, and others related. To apply in this case, Hongwei does not provide transparency since it failed to meet the deadline to submit their annual report, causing the share price to decline tremendously. In fact, as a result of inadequate internal control in the company, there were risks that occurred due to fraud, where the auditors could not obtain disclosure from management of the subsidiaries regarding the results of their assessments of the risk, whether the risk, the financial statement may be misstated as a result of fraud. For the second issue, which is does not comply with ethics and integrity value, according to these values, board should demonstrate a strong commitment to integrity and ethical values and possess the highest personal and professional ethics and be committed to represent the long-term interests of the organizations and its clients, customers, or stakeholders. However, in this case, Hongwei does not comply with ethics and integrity values since its both directors, Gary Menon and Jasmine Carr, have involved in unethical issues. Besides, there were legal claims against the company. There were also no commitments given by the management of team of the subsidiaries to the auditors, which led to incomplete audit work. And lastly, the board members do not possess professional ethics when they resign due to personal reasons without prior notice. Next, third issue or weakness is regarding weak reputation. Reputation is also one of corporate governance principles. Reputation is a very important aspect for a firm, especially a firm that is publicly listed. The share price of a company is usually directly and strongly correlated to the reputation of the firm, which may be good or bad. A company that has a good corporate governance system will maintain the confidence of investors, and as consequent, companies raise capital efficiently. However, in this case, Hongwei has a weak reputation, since it continuously making losses, which as a result, no dividend was paid and declared by the company, causing a significant discontent among major shareholders in the company. Besides, the delay in submitting the annual report causes the share price to drop, which affect the company's reputation in the eyes of investors.
Now, I will present the second question, which is the strategies on how to improve Hongwei's corporate governance issues. First of all, we need to appoint a competent board members. This is because the nominating committee should invest sufficient effort to identify board members with the necessary abilities and industry knowledge to assist the board. There should be a balance of board members who are familiar with the organization, board member who have relevant experience. What is vital for a board is that it is understand what talent it has and what skill it needs. For the second one, we need to evaluate board performance from time to time. If boards are to govern effectively, they must be noticed of their own strengths and flaws. Board effectiveness can only be measured if the board evaluates its own performance as well as the individual director on a regular basis. A board and director evaluation can result in improvements to areas such as board processes, director skills, competence and motivation. Any agreed upon actions resulting from an evaluation must be implemented and monitored. Last but not least, we can improve the problems by ensure timely information. Better decisions are made when information is available in real time. To maintain proper board supervision and direction, the management team must offer timely information. Interaction between the management team and the board are crucial to ensure that the board receives enough information. That's all from me. I will pass to the next presenter.
After that, there are some recommendations to improve Hongwei's auditing issues. First, have a proper reporting relationships between management and the audit committee. The audit committee of Hongwei should have positive working relationships with reporting senior management such that these managers are honest, transparent, responsive and appropriately accountable to the audit committee. If not, addressing this issue is warranted. The level of integrity of financial reporting management should be high. They should maintain confidentiality, manage conflicts of interest and responsible throughout their work. Second is effective communication. The importance of effective communication flows from the audit committee cannot be overstated. This includes written and in-person communication with management, internal and external audit and the board. For support in its oversight role, the audit committee relies on meaningful insight from management on emerging risks, concise and understandable meeting materials from management, unrestricted access to the auditors, direct access to teams and departments, including those outside of finance. Then, the third one is have an appropriate skills, competencies and expertise. Diversity of experience, perspectives and expertise as well as industry knowledge are extremely important, particularly given the widening mandates of audit committees beyond financial reporting oversight. Audit committee members need continuing development and education to help them keep up to date on the current issues. Then we move on to the company that having a similar issues with Hongwei. From the situation of Hongwei, there are two companies that can be related to the issue that is delayed to release their annual report due to failure to address audit issues. First is company ET. Company ET had delay in the announcement of its audit financial statement for the financial period from 1 September 2011 to 28 February 2013. The delay was due to the company failure in resolving the following audit issues. Second is case in Nigeria. The audit report delay is due to the size of the audit committee, firm size, board independence and board size. The independent directors are recognized to have an interest in quality and transparency of financial reporting. Therefore, these factors have affected the audit report to delay. As for the solution, they try to investigate the problems that causes to the audit delay and found out that the incremental audit effort, taxation, service and the use of less experienced audit staff were positively associated with the audit report delay. Therefore, they suggest that audit committee size should not be large, with a sufficient member having adequate knowledge in auditing and financial disclosures. They also specify the audit rules, choice of audit firm in order to avoid delay in preparation of audit reports. So, these two situations can be made as a reference for the problems that have been facing by Hongwei Berhad.
So now, let's move to question 3. There are some of criteria of industry attractiveness. First, power of buyers. Customers with buyer power can pressure industry margins by forcing companies to lower prices or improve the quality of services or goods they supply. Buyer power will rise if customers can easily switch to another supplier. Hence, this can force the firm to deliver a higher quality service at a reasonable price in order to retain customers. Second, power of suppliers. The ability of supplier to control pricing is examined in the power of suppliers. Similar to the buyer power, supplier power has an inverse connection with industry profitability since it may boost costs. Hence, the more suppliers there are, the better the firms are since they have a larger pool of vendors from which to choose. On the other hand, the fewer suppliers there are, the more influence providers have over price. Lastly is threat of new entrants. The threat of new entrants assesses the industry entry barriers, determining whether they are higher or lower. The greater the barriers to entry, the less trade existing entrance space. However, if the lower the barriers to entry, the simpler it will be for new rivals to enter the market. Hence, this will put existing competitors' businesses at risk. Based on the case, as for HHB, their target customer is mainly the young and middle-aged working adults. It is the top of their priority and commitment which to produce comfortable and high-quality shoe soles at affordable price. Even in the earlier stages, in order to ensure that the customer is satisfied with their product, they continuously strove to seek technical breakthrough as well as produce a trendy design which can fulfill customers' tastes. Plus, Hongwei are highly differentiated their products from the competitors. Hence, this will decrease the switching cost and also power of buyers. On the other hand, HHB has improved their internal raw material management, reduced manufacturing costs and reduced their reliance on third-party suppliers. This is because they have their own developed in-house manufacturer for their shoe soles, so they are not as reliant on vendors. In addition, they manufacture additional shoe soles for a different market. This is a low-cost firm since they make their own shoe soles rather than relying on vendors. Furthermore, supplier switching costs are more cheap because manufacturing is not entirely depend on a third party, and the corporation may readily move to alternative raw material suppliers. Last but not least, Hongwei has established as a well-known brand of high-quality footwear since they are in this industry more than 20 years. As a result, many people have been familiar with and loyal to the brand, which produce comfortable and high-quality shoe soles at a reasonable price. They conducted internal research as well as used more advanced technologies in order to improve the design of shoe soles. As a result, new entrants who have just recently begun to develop their brand names will find the difficulty to compete with them. Plus, new entrants are lack of technology like they do. Based on our opinion, even though HHP has faced several problems in the company, they are still attractive to be in the business. Next, I will pass to the next presenter.
Move on to the next question. How would you perceive Hongwei internal controls? Basically, there are 5 elements of good internal control, which are control environment, risk assessment, control activities, information and communication, lastly monitoring. Okay, let's take a look at the elements of internal control of Hongwei. First, under the environment, management of subsidiaries does not respond to the auditor. Ownership and recoverable amount of subsidiaries could not be determined. Second is risk. Hongwei faced some problems with the inventories. They are unable to ascertain whether the subsidiaries still had ownership over the inventories, and there is also this occurred due to fraud. Third, activities. Newly appointed directors had not been able to establish control over the operations since their appointment were acting without a functioning organization. Okay, fourth, information and communication. New independent directors were appointed to safeguard the interests of shareholders and ensure proper governance in Hongdi. Finally is monitoring. The company has no proper functioning board, leaving Gary Menon and Desmond Kaur as the board. Both of them also refused to communicate. Okay. By analyzing on 5 elements of the internal control, we can conclude that Hongwei has bad internal control.
After analyzing the case, we can conclude that corporate governance is a critical issue faced by all companies. The Hongwei Holdings Berhad case highlights the fact that poor corporate governance can lead to a downfall of even the largest companies. A corporate governance, including internal control, are essential elements in all companies. Therefore, every company should emphasize these elements in their organization by implementing and complying to corporate governance and internal control. So I guess that's all from our group. Thank you for your attention.